We'll explore World War I America at the Irving Archives and Museum, and we'll visit the Four Seasons for fine dining at Law. All this and more coming up about town. Hello, everyone, and welcome to About Town. I'm Kathy Whiteman. We're so glad you could join us today for details on the QB Sisters concert, courtesy of the entertainment series of Irving. We'll meet the winners of this year's Lone Star Youth Orchestra Concerto Competition, and we'll have Susan's predictions for this year's Oscars just in time for the award ceremony coming up April 25th. As always, we'd love for you to send us your feedback. Tell us about events going on around the community, interesting people we should profile, or stories you'd like to see on the show. You can email us at ictn@cityofirving.org or connect with us on social media. So please subscribe to our YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. We'd love to hear from you. 100 years ago, a global pandemic at a time of great social, political, and economic change transformed the nation. The new exhibit, World War I America, explores that era with some interesting parallels between then and now. Susan Stevens went to the Irving Archives and Museum to learn more.
In 1918 and 1919, World War I was overcome by an influenza epidemic that took the lives of millions.
Which we can connect to and really understand how, you know, traumatic that had to be, to have so many people dying and not really knowing, you know, how to control it and how it was spreading.
The Irving Archives and Museum is the premier venue for the new national traveling exhibition, World War I America. The exhibit takes a look back at the war and how America drastically changes during a short period of time.
It's pretty amazing how much actually happens in, you know, from 1914 to 1919, essentially. Of course, there's a world war, which, you know, was supposed to be the war to end all wars. And, you know, the U.S. slow movement to get involved in that war. We actually don't enter until 1917. And that really propels America in terms of how we approach world politics. The geopolitical landscape, of course, gets completely rewritten. There's, you know, women's suffrage. Just a lot is happening. You know, music and theater start to take off. You know, you think about movies and, you know, records being available. That's all within a decade of that.
Through the exhibit, we see a lot has happened, but some things have not changed.
There's racial strife. I mean, the migration, you know, really begins to change the demographics and the landscape of this country. Racial tensions are not isolated to the South, for sure. I mean, we see outbreaks of, you know, racial tensions in Chicago and Pittsburgh and Detroit. But then also, you know, there's resistance to mask wearing. There's prohibition, you know, this idea of banning alcohol, which obviously they repeal several years later, but, you know, this movement. And then there's things like the Red Scare and, you know, worries about anarchy. You know, there's government unrest. I think there's just a lot of parallels and things that, you know, maybe aren't exactly like what we're experiencing now, but we can see the parallels and connections.
The Irving Archives and Museum believe there's a lot to learn from this exhibit.
We can learn a lot of lessons, but also learn from mistakes. And that's what history does. It provides us context, and it provides us, you know, a plan and a book of, you know, here's things that worked and things that didn't. The original curator of the show was interviewed, and he said, you know, there must have been a point in 1919 when people woke up one day, looked around, and said, what just happened? And I connect with that. You know, I've had those moments myself in the last year.
The museum hopes the exhibit inspires the community to document current events and look into their own family's history.
I had always had an assumption that a great uncle had served in World War II, and it was actually World War I. You know, and so having those conversations and thinking about, you know, the veterans in our own families that served and the impact on our community.
Explore powerful images, read about vital stories, and discover the transformation of a divisive era.
I just really encourage people to take the opportunity to see this exhibition. I mean, it's exciting that we're the first stop, so we're the first ones to get to see it. But, you know, it's really a great program that we're able to bring such high quality, nationally traveling shows to Irving, and so I just really hope people take some time and come out to see the exhibition while it's here.
For About Towne, this is Susan Stevens.
Reserve a time for your exclusive visit to see the exhibit at IrvingArchivesAndMuseum.com. You've heard the term sibling rivalry. Well, you'll hear the sweetest sibling harmony this side of the Trinity when the Quaby sisters perform at Carpenter Hall, courtesy of the entertainment series of Irving. Johnny Pegues and Grace, Sophia, and Hulda Quaby join me now with all the details. Great to see you, ladies. Thanks so much for being here.
Thank you so much for having us. This was really fun. Thank you.
Johnny, what a great way to close out the entertainment series 2021 season. So give us a little intro. How did you guys find out about the Quaby sisters?
Well, I'll tell you, Kathy, I had heard of the Quaby sisters, and I saw them perform on a show on TV one night, and then we discovered they were touring. Well, I went nuts thinking that we would love to have them here, and sure enough, we were able to coordinate a date. And it's the only date that they're doing in DFW this year. So they're closing our 65th season, which entertainment series of Irving has been in existence for 65 years in Irving, bringing entertainment to the masses, so to speak. And so we thought it was a tremendous way to close our 65th season to have these ladies come and perform for us.
Well, and to find out that they're from the area, which is wonderful, and to find out that this is the only date they had available in the area, that makes it a little bit special. So, folks, you better get those tickets real quickly.
We are just thrilled. And, yes, there are still tickets available. Not a many, but a few. So we'd be happy to have people fill out the auditorium now that we can offer more seats than we were able to.
Yeah, and that's really good news, too. So, ladies, let me ask a couple of questions. Grace, I'm going to start with you. You guys have been playing together since you were kids. How'd you get started?
We got started by attending a fiddle contest at the North Texas State Fair in Denton one year, and we heard fiddling for the first time and just fell in love and got into contest fiddling. And then from there, my sisters and I got into Western swing and playing together and playing in harmony. So that's how our Western Swing Band and our band got started. And today we play lots of different styles of traditional music, especially regionally to Texas. And we love playing and singing together.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know that you guys that you call what you're doing progressive Western swing. So it sounds like there's been some evolution over the years. Sophia, tell us about that. How's the band evolved over the years?
Well, we started out just as an instrumental group, and then later, after the urgings of Ricky Skaggs primarily to get us started singing, we incorporated vocals in. And, you know, over the years, we have just always drawn in, as Grace was saying, a lot of different of our favorite styles. You know, first it was Western swing, and then some jazz influence, and obviously country music. And then
Western music,
absolutely. But I think what the biggest thing that we kind of hold in our heart right now is really retaining the kind of the core element that, you know, Bob Wills and the Texas Playboys had at the heart of their music, and so many great jazz innovators. And that is, in the words of Duke Ellington, if I'm quoting him correctly, that tradition is innovation. And so we don't want to just play. We don't want to just kind of play an older genre of music and songs as sort of like a museum piece kind of thing. We want to bring fresh things into it. We want to keep pushing the boundaries just a little bit and kind of adding new twists to it, just to keep things artistically evolving along and while retaining that spirit of the all the different, you know, what you would call maybe traditional styles that we
Yeah. There's something really wonderful about honoring the roots of something, as you guys are doing, and then also sort of, you don't want to necessarily say elevating it, because it's a beautiful thing where it is, but adding to it so that people can continue to appreciate it. So I think that's beautiful. I also think it's wonderful that you guys are writing original music now. So Hulda, I want to ask you if you would mind sharing a story about how your sister wrote a song for your wedding day.
Well, you know, it's pretty special because it's the very first song that any of the three of us, you know, ever completely wrote, you know, and I had no clue about it because I was getting married, And then Sophia literally, you know, comes, I walk into my wedding reception and I'm like, there's a whole PA system set up. What's going on? Sophia surprised me. She wrote a song for me, arranged it, everything, got our friends to come play with her. And that was the very first song that she ever wrote. And then, so, you know, the evolution since then to now is on our latest album, we have originals that Sophia has written and they've co-written and we've all arranged, and Sophia wrote a song with our bass player, Daniel Parr. So it's been really fun, really challenging. We're still learning the whole art of songwriting, but we're really loving it. And it's just fun to add to it. Like Sophia wrote a happy country shuffle song, which is you don't hear of happy country shuffles very often. So, hey, you know, you can do whatever you want.
But and there you go. When you're the writer, it's your story that you get to tell. So before I let you guys go, Grace, if you would just tell us, are we going to get a chance to hear some of that original music? And what can we look forward to at the concert?
Yes, well, we play fiddles. And then we have stand-up bass and archtop guitar. And so we're a small band, five-piece, but my sisters and I also sing in harmony. And so that's the instrumentation of the group, but we play Western swing, of course, Texas-style fiddling. You can expect to hear cowboy and Western tunes. We love the Sons of the Pioneers. And, you know, swing and jazz music is a staple of what we do and, mm-hmm. and a lot of the backbone of what we strive to impart that dance feel in our music. So we love a lot of things, and we love to pull in a little bit of gospel, maybe a little bit of blues as well. So that's kind of a synopsis of what you'd hear.
It sounds like it's going to be quite a night. Johnny, give us the details.
Oh, absolutely. I'll be happy to. May the 1st, Irving Arts Center at 7:30 p.m. That's a Saturday, so you don't have to go home early. You can come and party with us. And tickets are still available at the Irving Arts Center. Just go to their website or our website, and you can go right there.
Fantastic. Folks, don't miss the Quaby Sisters in concert. For tickets, you can call 972-252-ARTS. And for more information, visit entertainmentseries.com. Thanks for being here, ladies.
Appreciate it. Thank you,
John. Yeah. Oh, yeah. We'll see you guys in a couple of weeks.
Yeah.
Have a safe trip.
Appreciate it.
Bye.
The movie industry anthem, Hooray for Hollywood, has never felt more appropriate than this year as we get ready for a socially distanced Academy Awards. Here's Susan with her predictions for who will take home those coveted golden statues.
Even a pandemic won't stop the Oscars from honoring some of the best films of the year. And believe it or not, Hollywood was still able to release some award-worthy movies during 2020. Now it's time once again for me to discuss and predict the winners of some of the biggest awards of the night, beginning with my favorite category, Best Original Screenplay. Last year, Parasite swept with 4 wins, including Best Picture, Best Director, and Best Original Screenplay. This year, there's only one film that's comparatively unique. The nominees are Judas and the Black Messiah, Minari, Promising Young Woman, The Sound of Metal, and The Trial of the Chicago 7. If Promising Young Woman doesn't win this award, I will be shocked and livid. It is not only the most original nominee, but Emerald Fennell wrote an intense and comical, provocative revenge thriller that keeps you guessing till the very end.
It's a day of reckoning. For everyone.
The biggest shoe-ins this year are Best Actor and Best Supporting Actor. Go ahead and mark your ballots with Daniel Kaluuya for Best Supporting in Judas and the Black Messiah, and the late, great Chadwick Boseman for Best Actor in Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. Both gave unbelievable performances and already earned Golden Globes and Critics' Choice Awards. They are also my personal pick in both categories. Both actress categories are not quite as predictable. The nominees for Supporting Actress are Maria Bakalova for Borat 2, Olivia Colman for The Father, Amanda Seyfried for Mank, Glenn Close for Hillbilly Elegy, and Yeo Jung-yoon for Minari.
Dress with
Things look bright for Bakalova after winning at the Critics' Choice Awards. I have wanted her to win ever since I watched her brave and hilarious performance in the Borat sequel. But Yoon has recently collected some gold from other award shows, and that might just be the momentum she needs to score the final touchdown at the biggest award show of the season. Both are deserving, but my money's on Yoon. Now I'm truly stumped with this year's Best Actress category. But here are the nominees. Viola Davis for Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, Andra Day for The U.S. versus Billie Holiday, Vanessa Kirby for Pieces of a Woman, Frances McDormand for Nomadland, and Carey Mulligan for Promising Young Woman. Aside from Kirby, each of the other four actresses have won at an award show this season. All five nominees are fantastic, but I think this is really going to be between Davis, Day, and Mulligan. I honestly can't say who's going to win this award, but I can say who I'd like to.
How old am I?
Carey Mulligan is at her best in Promising Young Woman. She shows such complex emotions and varies from cold-hearted to heartbreaking. It's a performance that stayed with me all year.
What's my name?
And finally, the biggest award of the night. Here are the eight films nominated for Best Picture. The Father, Judas and the Black Messiah, Mank, Minari, Nomadland, Promising Young Woman, Sound of Metal, and The Trial of the Chicago Seven. Well, if you've been keeping up with the award season, you'd know Nomadland, the story of a woman who has lost everything and has decided to travel in her van as a modern-day nomad, is almost a lock for the win. But if you also know the Oscars, then you know this category can always surprise us. Personally, I would love for Promising Young Woman to shock us all with that win. Or I would be happy to see Minari take the Golden Statue after telling a beautiful story about a Korean family starting a life in America during the 80s. I've got my fingers crossed, but I'm not holding my breath. The safe choice on your ballot would be Nomadland. But the history of Hollywood's biggest night has taught us that anything can happen at the Oscars. So be sure to find out how my thoughts and predictions compare to the actual winners when the Academy Awards air on Sunday, April 25th on ABC. For About Town, this is Susan Stevens.
Check out more of Susan's movie reviews and celebrity interviews online at thischicksflix.com. You don't have to go all the way to Hollywood for a luxurious fine dining experience. Just travel to Law at the Four Seasons Resort and Club for fine dining, Texas style. Susan Stevens has more.
Chef Paolo Gamma of Law at the Four Seasons Los Clinas is prepping ingredients to make dishes from the restaurant's new spring menu.
We change our menu every season. We're gonna do a charred octopus with a parsley pesto. We have our own dry age program in house. So we're doing a dry age duck. We will also be doing a pasta carbonara with a sous vide egg crack on top. That's gonna help you to keep it moisture on the pasta.
Law has been a part of the Four Seasons Los Clinas for 6 years, serving Texas flair gourmet cuisine. They use ingredients inspired by local flavors found in our state's land, air, and water.
We do our own charcuterie, and we have special dinners through the year. Sometimes we make wine dinners, so we make pairings with different wines, and we make five, six, seven course dinner, and you enjoy the dinner with special plates that we just create for that moment. So,
wood chips are lit and smoke is bottled to create the restaurant's popular and classic smoked Manhattan.
We make it with agave and then we smoke it with mesquite. It's every time I come to enjoy my restaurant, I really ask for that drink.
Chef Paolo says the eclectic menu and quality service keeps customers coming back.
We have a lot of regular guests that are always coming to the restaurant. It feels super comfortable to go outside, greet the tables. People knows you, you know the people, so it just makes the conversation easier and the service too. You know, it's you know what they like, what they don't like. The service guys are super on top of the tables. If you have an allergy, a restriction, that's the first thing they're gonna come inside of my kitchen and tell me, "Chef, we have a this request on this table," and we try to accommodate.
And if you're coming in for a special event, Law takes extra steps to make that experience more memorable.
So along with our pastry chefs, we personalize all the desserts for celebrations. Also, if you're celebrating with a big party, we personalize your menus. So celebrations are very, very important for us.
With such passion for food, we asked what made Paolo want to become a chef.
I was raised by a chef. My mom was a chef. So I pretty much grew up in running between kitchen tables and knives and fire. Quite dangerous for a kid. The first time I was able to grab a professional chef knife and actually work as a task, I was 10 years old. So it came out very natural for me. I was just gonna be dedicated to this.
And his dedication is part of the reason why Chef Paulo invites everyone to rediscover law at the Four Seasons Las Clinas.
Give us the opportunity to feed you and nurture you with our food, and I'm pretty sure everybody's gonna enjoy it.
For About Town, this is Susan Stevens.
The Four Seasons Resort and Club is located at 4150 North MacArthur Boulevard. Reserve your table at 972-717-2420 or online at fourseasons.com/Dallas/restaurants/law. The Lone Star Youth Orchestra concludes their 2021 season with a concert featuring the Three B's and showcasing the winners of this year's concerto competition. Here with the details are Dr. Kevin Pierce and Concerto Award winner Iris Song. Thank you guys so much for being here today.
It's great to be here, Kathy. Thanks for having us.
So Dr. Pierce, the Three B's featured in your concert aren't who classical music audience typically think of. So who are your Three B's and why did you select them for this concert?
We have an arrangement of the last movement of the first symphony of Johannes Brahms. It's an arrangement that I've always wanted to play with this orchestra, and it's the first time that we actually get to do so. And then our two concerto competition winners. It just so happened that both of these young ladies played a movement of a concerto for violin by Johann Sebastian Bach. And so when looking for a third piece, I wanted to feature the music of Reynard Burns, who's a contemporary American composer. And totally by coincidence, we ended up with three composers whose last names begin with B. So we are marketing this music as we're playing the Three B's, Bach, Brahms, and Burns, with apologies to Beethoven.
I love that. I think that's great. So Iris, you are one of the winners of this year's competition. I'd really love to know what the experience was like for you.
The experience was definitely a privilege. It's an opportunity I don't think I will ever have again. And to be able to perform with an orchestra, this concert is an honor.
So, Iris, what advice would you give to other young musicians who might want to compete in the next concerto competition?
My advice would be to be confident. And it doesn't matter if you mess up or if you're bad, but music is about expressing yourself. And take advantage of any opportunity to practice or perform.
I think that is really great advice. We've got about 30 seconds left, Dr. Pierce. If you could tell us when the concert is coming up, and I think you also have a message about the auditions coming up in August.
All right, so the concert is on the 12th of May coming up. It's on a Wednesday evening. I believe it starts at 7. And then we have some auditions for the next season. And those come up in near the end of August, August the 21st, and the other one is on August the 28th.
Fantastic. And folks, I understand that especially if you are a string instrument player, you might want to secure a spot early. The concert, the Three B's, with apologies to Beethoven, is Wednesday, May 12th at 7 p.m. in Carpenter Hall. Call 972-252-ARTS. For tickets and learn more about the Lone Star Youth Orchestra at lascalinasymphony.org/LSYO. And you can secure your audition spot online while you're there. Thanks for being here today. I appreciate it.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Here's a look at more of the artwork from the Irving ISD Annual Exhibition of High School Art and a list of wildly imaginative things to do about town. And here are a couple of edifying ways to spend your time in our happenings about town. You can sign up for lifeguard certification at the American Red Cross classes on Saturday, April 24th and 25th from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. at the North Lake College Natatorium. Learn more at cityofirving.org/2937/lifeguards-and-employment. And you can explore the visual arts at the Irving Arts Center's Lunch and Learn series. The next opportunity is Tuesday, April 27th at noon via Zoom. Find more details and register at irvingartscenter.com. And that wraps up this edition of About Town. Thanks for joining us. Please be sure to tune in next time for a look at a preview of Main Stage Irving Las Colinas' Bell, Book, and Candle. We'll also check out Poses on the Plaza at the Toyota Music Factory, and we'll have highlights from Momentum Dance Company's United We Dance. We'll leave you tonight with a little preview from that wonderful evening of dance. I'm Kathy Whiteman. Thanks for joining us. Have a great evening, and we'll see you about town.
In the sky.